Mesos and Kubernetes are tools for distributed systems management. Kubernetes is built with an emphasis on running services, whereas Mesos is commonly used for a wider variety of workloads, including data infrastructure like Spark and Kafka. Mesos can also be used as a platform to provide resource management for Kubernetes, and we get into that discussion of the interaction between Kubernetes and Mesos if you're running both of them today. My guest is Dharmesh Kakadia. He's the author of Apache Mesos Essentials, and he spent time studying both Mesos and Kubernetes. He joins the show to explain the strengths of both platforms and how they can be used together. In addition to dissecting Mesos and Kubernetes, we had a wide-ranging discussion from cloud providers to software architecture to business strategy. If you're going to be in the Bay Area on January 11th, I want to plug the Software Engineering Daily Meetup. There's going to be awesome speakers. There's going to be food, a positive atmosphere. It's going to be a lot of fun. It's totally free. Find more information on softwareengineeringdaily.com or at the Software Engineering Daily Meetup page. I hope to see you there. When I'm choosing the tools for my side projects, the first thing that I look for is ease of use. That's why I love MongoDB. It is the most popular non-relational database, and it is super easy to use. At the beginning of a project, I often don't know the shape of my objects, and Mongo makes it easy to evolve the database schema as I like over time. Over time, as my project gets popular, I'm going to need to scale, and thankfully, MongoDB has built-in horizontal scalability, but configuration and database maintenance aren't really what I want to spend my time on. Thankfully, MongoDB Atlas was released in 2016. MongoDB Atlas is the easiest way to get access to MongoDB without having to run the database yourself. You pay only for what you use, from small projects all the way up to large production deployments. To try MongoDB Atlas today, go to mongodb.com/sedaily and get a free $25 in credit. Use promo code GOATLAS25 to get that $25 in free credit. Atlas is the only hosted MongoDB service built by the engineers behind the database, the company MongoDB. With Atlas, you get end-to-end encryption. You get VPC peering. You get access to the latest releases. And for a limited time, you can go to mongodb.com/sedaily, enter promo code GOATLAS25, and get that $25 in credit and get started with MongoDB Atlas. Thanks to MongoDB for being a new sponsor of Software Engineering Daily, and thanks for being the database behind a lot of my favorite side projects in the past. We're really happy to have MongoDB as a new sponsor of Software Engineering Daily. Dharmesh Kakadia is the author of Apache Mesos Essentials. Dharmesh, welcome to SE Daily.
Hey, Jeff. Good to be here.
Yeah, it's great to have you. And the reason that we're doing this episode is because you and I had an email exchange about Mesos and Kubernetes. These are two tools for distributed systems management. Of course, distributed systems management is a vague term. How do you define this class of tools when we're talking about things like Mesos and Kubernetes?
So I think the general class is tools of the managing distributed systems is like the multiple silos. There are orchestrator, there are managers, there are configuration management, like all suit of tools. I think what Kubernetes and Mesos in particular are good at, both are good at, is what I would generally call a data center OS or infrastructure OS, and which basically manages right from your infrastructure installation to all the way the lifecycle of the application and like everything in between. So
yeah, they really, Mesos and Kubernetes both simplify the operations of a cluster of compute nodes. And
yeah, one of the things, not only these are operational tools, I think the one of the big difference between this Mesos Kubernetes and the previous versions like Chef and Ansible and all sort of those tools, because Chef and Ansible were primarily ops tools, while Kubernetes and Mesos are targeted to dev tools, which are also good for ops. So I think that's a big difference.
And the Chef and Puppet suite of tools were more about writing scripts and executing them, right? It wasn't like a full-fledged like application platform abstraction thing, right?
Yeah, so that's like precisely the point. Like, why it, since they are ops tools, that means it is targeted to ops audience and just to automating the scripts and things that they manually used to write. That, and while the Mesos and Kubernetes are targeted to a DevOps developers to write distributed applications. So, like that's why you see very different kind of audience, very different set of interest in these technologies.
Mesos and Kubernetes have some differences. They also have some overlapping functionality. What are the common characteristics between Mesos and Kubernetes?
So I think Mesos and Kubernetes both are very good at distributed at writing distributed systems. Like if you are a developer who is writing distributed app or using distributed app, both serve very good purpose. There are minor differences in how they what abstraction they choose and what level at they work in, but by and large they are both the good tools for distributed application writing. So by distributed application writing, I mean things like Spark, Hadoop, or things like master slave web servers. All things which run on more than few machines, and which is the reality in the modern infrastructure.
And one thing you told me is that Mesos is at a lower level and it knows how to do resource management. What do you mean by that?
So I think it's very it's a bit confusing, but when I mentioned that, I think the thing to keep in mind is there are two problems in infrastructure space: resource allocation and resource scheduling. So resource allocation is this problem of allocating resources, which basically decides which application gets what resource, and then it sort of gets out of the way and it doesn't try to decide what the resources are used for. While scheduling is the problem which decides what to do with the resource once it is allocated to an application. So traditionally, this has been coupled into a single monolith kind of a infrastructure piece, where the piece of component that is responsible for resource allocation is also something that is responsible for scheduling, which generally is less scalable. And Mesos and Borg and this kind of system started basically separating them out gave birth of this thing called two-phase schedulers, where Mesos, for example, is just responsible for resource allocation, while the application-specific scheduling happens within the application, and it can be arbitrarily complex while keeping the Mesos simple. Come again? What was the question? Sorry.
No. That was not a question. Well, I mean, the original question was, how do they do resource management? What does it mean that Mesos does resource management? What you're talking about with these customized schedulers, I mean, I did a show a while ago about Netflix using Mesos, and they were talking about, well, the guest was talking about the custom schedulers that they were writing for applications, and
that's a very big asset. That's a very big asset of Mesos, that you can customize the application in a way that suits your application need. And to your original question, what I mean by Mesos is the lower level in the stack versus the Kubernetes is, so Mesos is like a data center kernel, right? So you can think of it just like your normal kernel, that normal Linux kernel, but extended to a data center. So it just does the resource allocation, just does the isolation, resource allocation, and resource management, not the scheduling part. Like if you are writing a C program in a normal Linux system, you would sort of try to so you basically allocate memory, and you would decide what happens with that memory, not your kernel. Kernel is just responsible for giving you a chunk of memory, and that's it. It gets out of the way. So similarly, Mesos at the lower level and just decides to give you what resources you need and just gets out of the way. While Kubernetes, on the other hand, or the other service scheduler like Marathon or Aurora or Kronos or like a number of other service scheduler, are sort of managing both of this. So they sort of act as a mediator between your application and the resource management as well. So So Kubernetes, for when you say it's run the pods, so Kubernetes will not only try to get resources for you, it will also make sure that the pods are up, and it will keep monitoring, and it is responsible for restarting the pods and rescheduling the pods and things like that. So that's why it's a higher level of abstraction versus versus the Mesos. And because it's a different level of abstraction, you can actually run Kubernetes on Mesos and along with other frameworks and get the benefit of Mesos and Kubernetes both.
You characterize Mesos as being particularly useful for data workloads, like data infrastructure workloads like Spark and Kafka, perhaps Flink. There's the Mantis framework for Netflix. And then in contrast, Kubernetes is a great model to run services. So can you give more color to that? Like what is it about this resource management model of Mesos that makes it better suited to doing data infrastructure workloads? And what is it about Kubernetes that makes it a better model for doing services?
So if you think about that, so Kubernetes, so there is only one way of doing things, more or less. Like there is a new proposal of new scheduling and multiple schedulers and all. But by and large, and right now, the state of the world is there's only one way of doing things, where you give the and the worldview is like there's a state machine and that you give to Kubernetes, and Kubernetes will try to make sure it is being followed. That's precisely, I think, that's the way I like to think about the Kubernetes worldview, where
declarative syntax. This is what I want. This is what I want it to always be. And if some perturbation happens, then make things
do this.
Go back.
Yeah. So that's why it's a great model for services, because services are sort of having a well-defined state machine where you know what to do and what not to do, which is not true for other application. Like for example, Spark or any database application or any data infrastructure application, you want to take different actions based on number of things, like based on how much data is being. So for example, like if I give you an example of things like Hadoop things like database application running on Mesos versus Kubernetes. So if database application, it might not be a good idea at times, even if it is one instance is killed. It might, by bringing up the instance at somewhere else in the world, like just because there was a small network glitch, it actually might end up hurting the database, right? So because it will flood the replication and all sort of things. So as an application scheduler in Mesos, you can decide for yourself what actions you want to take, rather than giving this declarative syntax to Kubernetes and let him do everything. So basically, Kubernetes has this worldview where everything is a state machine and there is one way of doing things, which works great for services, which works for in fact 70-80% of the application out there. But it sort of loses this flexibility in choosing what to do when things go bad or you need to change things. Whenever there is a dynamic decision involved, I think Mesos frameworks are much better suited. So if you think about I think the Netflix example is great. The other example is something like Twitter Heron, which is any streaming service, for example. You can do different things when things go wrong or workload increases and the application framework is the one who knows this better than I think the generalized scheduler, which is Kubernetes.
So you've got a bacon delivery service, and you need to notify your customers when their bacon has arrived at their doorstep. Twilio helps you make sure your customers get the bacon while it's hot. Twilio's programmable API lets you build SMS or voice alerts easily in the programming language of your choice, all in under 5 minutes with only a few lines of code. Now your customers get a text or a call the instant their bacon is ready. If your customers want to see the bacon frying on a hot pan, Twilio has video APIs and SDKs for the platforms that you know and love. Learn more at go.twilio.com/podcast and get an additional $10 when you sign up and upgrade your account. That's go.twilio.com/podcast. You will only pay for what you use, and it costs less than a penny to send a text. Get started at go.twilio.com/podcast. Get your bacon delivery service cooking with Twilio's APIs for voice, SMS, and video. if I want to use whatever streaming system I'm using, whether it's Heron from Twitter or Mantis from Netflix or Spark or Flink, why would I want customized schedulers? And how is that schedule, that idea of a scheduler, interacting with the stream data processing framework? Like, if I've got some, like if I'm Netflix, you know, I've got tasks like I want to process, you know, as data is coming in from like a user consuming a movie. Like a user is consuming a movie, and throughout that consumption of a movie, they're pausing the movie. Maybe they're moving their mouse around in different ways. And Netflix wants to process all those actions in a streaming fashion. Perhaps that's different for how Twitter is processing all of the user interactions with tweets, for example. You know, if I'm looking at Twitter for an hour and I'm interacting with tweets in all these different ways, Twitter wants some stream processing framework to be able to process all of my actions as they're coming into the system. Talk some about why these different companies build, I mean, first of all, why they build different streaming frameworks for their different applications, and then why they build customized schedulers for how those applications, those streaming applications, get resources.
Sure. So why they build different streaming frameworks is a long discussion. I think streaming is one of those scenarios where it's like a configuration management in many sense. Like if you see, for 5 years, like everybody in the world were using their own bash scripts where it was very specific to their needs, serves them well. But more and more, yeah, I think there are so streaming framework, I think, is again one of those areas where there are different trade-offs that you can make, and I think different systems make different trade-offs. I think that's where some of the frameworks give more importance to consistency versus the latency, where others tries to be more latency sensitive while sacrificing some of the consistency. In terms of custom schedulers that you mentioned, like I want to be clear that whenever I say custom scheduler, it's not like some big piece of code. Like most of the custom schedulers in Mesos are like pretty small, like because the abstraction is so nice, and the fact that most of these distributed applications like Kafka, like Flink, or like Heron already is a master-slave application, where already there is this notion of scheduling, or in the traditional sense, for example, any YARN app will have the application master. So this is a piece of code that already exists on most of the schedulers, which sort of decides what happens, how to run this particular thing. Like if it is a Spark, it says how to run this particular DAG. If it is a Kafka, it sort of says where this particular piece of data goes and how it is processed, how long it is kept before it's discarded and all that stuff. So these pieces are already there. I think writing a custom scheduler for that in Mesos is so easy. And that's another reason why Mesos has got so popular, and it's very, very user friendly. In fact, if you are trying to write a new distributed application, it's you know, pretty hard, pretty easy compared to writing your own application from the scratch. So I give this example of if you give someone a task of writing a hello world in C, for example, they'll write like 4 line or 5 line of program and they'll be done with it. Now you say them that, okay, you need to write the same hello world program, but there is no OS. So then they need to do the scheduling, they need to do hardware management, they need to do device management, like you name it. So writing distributed application without distributed data center infrastructure OS is like writing a hello world. Even if you're trying to write a hello world program, it will take all the efforts in the world, not only to write, also to run. So Mesos gives us nice primitives of how to write a distributed application without sweating, basically.
What are some of those parameters that you can tune? How do you write a custom scheduler? You mentioned, you know, the things that you're tuning on a scheduler for Kafka are different than what you're tuning for a scheduler for Heron or some other streaming framework. How does that, what are the parameters that you tune? How do you write a scheduler?
So scheduling abstraction in as a framework, you in Mesos, you are served some offers, resource offers. So that's the concept. And resource offers are basically the chunk of resource that
so the data
resource,
center has some spare computers. You are a framework, and the data center says, "Hey, would you like this resource?"
Yes, so it's precisely that way. So it will say, okay, you know, I have this 2 CPU and 4 GB of RAM lying around, or 100 CPU and 128 GB of RAM lying around. Do you want it? So it will try to give this resource offers to different frameworks depending on the priority and DRF and all. But as a framework, you don't need to worry about like how you get resources. So you just need to implement an API that says what happens when you get resource offer. So you can say, okay, if I'm a Kafka and I need 3 instances and my current number of instances less than blah, like, okay, I'll take that offer if it satisfies my need. And just acknowledge Mesos that, okay, I need this offer. Thank you very much for that. Once you receive offer, you can do what is called executors in Mesos terminology. So what the executor is basically what to do with once you have now you've got the resources. Now what do you want to do with the resource? Okay, yeah, I want to launch a Kafka slave on that, or I want to launch a Spark task on that. So, and that's very application specific, but it's again, as I'm saying, like this is already something that most of the schedulers already know how to do. Like how to launch a Spark slave is very like known in the Spark world, or how to launch a Kafka slave is typically, these are just one line scripts or one API calls in most of the frameworks. So writing a scheduler, that's why even though it's the application needs are very different, from the writing point of view, it's very, very simple.
So you've talked about putting Kubernetes on Mesos. We did a show, I think it was like a year ago, with Michael Hausenblas from Mesos, and he talked about putting Kubernetes on Mesos, and I think at that point I was like really just getting my feet wet in these topics. I didn't really understand why you would do this. I didn't understand how, but now I think I'm starting to understand it, because you would have Mesos that is the really wide scope thing that is managing your data center, and then you've got streaming jobs, you've got batch jobs, and the idea of streaming is just like the best definition for streaming I've heard is the data never stops coming. So you always have something to do because the data is always coming in. So you know how you want to prioritize that is going to depend on what your application is. You know, some systems are going to have higher priority jobs for data processing. But on the other hand, your services, you know, you're probably going to have some services that you want to just stay up all the time. You're always going to want to have compute resources available for these services. I mean, like, you know, Gmail, right? Gmail has a bunch of services that are just standing up all the time. So if you want to request your email, you can get it instantly. You don't have this problem of like, you know, making a request and then some load balancer on Google's side says, oh, we need to make available, you know, more Gmail clusters because we're scaling up. Google always wants to have a cluster of Gmail servers available for you to access. So these requirements for clusters for Kubernetes, like managing services, are somewhat different than the requirements for data processing clusters, where, you know, maybe you have low latency requirements, maybe you don't, maybe they're variable, but like Kubernetes clusters for managing services, you just want these up all the time.
Yeah, so I think that's a very, very nice way to put it. Like you will always, services composes of like the 70 to 80% of the workload in the world, but there are always going to be this data infrastructure. There is always going to be this custom way of doing things that is available on Mesos. So even before Kubernetes was there, right? I mean, Mesos had so Twitter being one of the biggest users, they had this framework called Apache Aurora. I don't know if you have. So Apache Aurora basically is like a service scheduler, which does a lot of declarative things like Kubernetes. It defines a state machine, and it has a declarative syntax of saying what to do when this particular piece of code goes up or down, or how to scale things, how to monitor this. So it has been there in the Mesos world. Apache Aurora and Marathon has been there for quite some time, and both are a fairly mature project. I think what Kubernetes brought it with it is two things. One is the great community. I think that's something that is very essential. But also I think they got the service notion very right in the sense that you have network mesh that is always available. You don't need to configure explicit DNS. You don't need to configure explicit network. That is all out of the box for you as a service. So I think that what this means is if you configure the same service in Apache Aurora versus in Kubernetes, as a service writer, you have much less declarative syntax to deal with, rather than on the Aurora, your typical files are like hundreds of lines of code, declarative syntax. And that sort of gets into the way of developing people, people who are developing services. So Kubernetes basically said, like, we'll give you a out-of-the-box nice experience for running services, and it's great. That's why I like almost always say to people who are like into startups or small companies, like, always start with Kubernetes, because that's where I think most companies start, like run a web service, run a website. And as you grow, because after you have grown, you will have data needs, you will have the needs to scale infrastructure, you will also want to. So other thing that Mesos gives you is this portability across your infrastructure. You can be running Mesos if you're developing against Mesos. So if your frameworks are developing against Mesos, you can be running on AWS today and Azure tomorrow, and on your own infrastructure the next day, without touching and rewriting the codes and configuration. So I think that's the other reason why you want to have some infrastructure OS that takes care of all this.
The architecture that you've described about Mesos being something you can run Kubernetes on, certainly compelling to me. When I've done interviews with Google people, Kubernetes, it's Kubernetes all the way down. Like, that's my, when I'm talking to them, it just seems like it's Kubernetes all the way down, and I don't have any conversations with them where I haven't so far. Maybe I'm not asking the right questions, where they say, oh yeah, we still have, so Kubernetes is based on this Borg, Google Borg project, the Google Borg thing that manages all of Google's data centers and data workloads and services and whatnot. And Kubernetes is based on this. But in the conversations I have with them, it's never like, oh yeah, Kubernetes runs on Borg. It's always like, Kubernetes, we just have Kubernetes. So why, what's the difference there? Is there some way to use Kubernetes where it is your full stack thing and you don't need to run Kubernetes on Mesos? And what am I missing from these two different types of architectures where you have Kubernetes just on your data center versus Mesos on your data center and Kubernetes on your Mesos?
So I'm not sure about the Google. I've never worked there, so I would be surprised if their 100% of the workload is on Kubernetes, especially at this point in time. Although you should consider is the fact that both of these projects, like Mesos and Kubernetes, are pretty fast moving projects. So there is a cross pollination between the project's ideas, and so Kubernetes, as I was saying, there is a recent proposal of multiple schedulers, which still sort of is bolted on, if you ask me. But that's where they also realize that there's no one scheduler fits all ever if you want to go full stack on Kubernetes, you're going to be bounded to have different schedulers. So they are having this the conversation about so there's SIG for the schedulers going on, where there's a conversation about having multiple schedulers. I can go into much detail, but I think it the optimistic offer model of the Kubernetes, it's very interesting. Once you get to see more and more schedulers, it's going to run more and more run into a lot of conflicts. In terms of optimistic concurrency control. So that's my worldview right now. Like, it's not Kubernetes full stack is probably hard, if not nearly impossible, at least at this point in time.
What are these optimistic concurrency challenges?
If you think about schedulers, right? So there are two ways to like in the traditional database system, there are two ways to manage resources. One is the optimistic way, and one is the pessimistic way. So the Mesos is a pessimistic way. So pessimistic way means if I give resources to one framework, I will mark those resources as used and will not offer these resources to anyone else. So while the optimistic worldview is that, okay, I can give these offers to multiple of people and probably they will not collide. Probably they'll be okay. I think that's one of the big difference in terms of architecture and scheduling point of view. So what this means is some pessimistic worldview can give you a little less utilization at the on the other hand, it will give you a much better SLA. While on the optimistic worldview, it can hurt your SLA a bit and can give you a higher utilization. Now, having said that, as I was saying, there's a cross-pollination of ideas. So Mesos now has things to compensate for the utilization in the form of optimistic resource offers and reservations. And Kubernetes is considering multiple schedulers. So when you have the multiple schedulers, as long as you have one scheduler, this optimistic offers does not make a big difference in the Kubernetes worldview. But if you have multiple of schedulers, which and you give resources to both of them, there can be conflicts. Now, and then in the Kubernetes, there is a way to detect and resolve this conflict, but it's not, as I'm saying, like, as if you have more and more schedulers into your infrastructure, you're going to see more and more conflict, and it will not scale, basically.
What if you allocate specific, I mean, if you have multiple schedulers but you allocate explicit resources to each scheduler, then there's not necessarily a conflict, right? It would only be if you have multiple schedulers that are trying to schedule the same resources.
If you mean that, so then it will basically boil down to static partitioning, and that's an old way of managing infrastructure. That means you lose all the dynamic utilization, all sort of benefits. And once you, for example, you don't want your Hadoop jobs to be running fine if your web server is dying and the website is down. So that's I think the problem. I think that's why you need, at the level of infrastructure wise, you need a visibility of multiple schedulers and have a way to deal with it.
Although you could have another scheduler that schedules resources into the two static partitions.
Yes, and that's Mesos. And if you think about it, that's precisely what Mesos is. Like, it basically gives you resources and gets out of the way. Like, and then you do whatever you want to do.
But if Kubernetes did the multiple scheduler thing, you could have layers of schedulers, what would be different between Kubernetes and Mesos?
There are differences. I think for many frameworks, it might not matter in the long run. Like, if, I don't know, like 10 years down the line, both projects might be equally good. What I would say is this notion that the worldview of Kubernetes is only one. So if you think about it, right, everything, all the request to Kubernetes goes through API gateway. Like, that gives them a sort of a little better user experience, but at the same time, it limits their like what to do. Like, if you are an application framework which sort of doesn't care, for example, about rate limiting or things like that, you cannot get out of that worldview in Kubernetes. I think, and the Mesos, you don't care. Like I give you resources, you manage your resources. I just don't want to be involved in the management of your resources, how to do things for you. So that also reflects in how the frameworks are being developed. So if you are in the Mesos world, you can use almost all the tools out of the box that are framework specific. Like, if you are running Hadoop on Mesos, you can use all the Hadoop tools without changing anything, or Kafka tools, which are like all the things that basically are can be affected by this notion that there is only one worldview in Kubernetes. So there are tools, for example, if it's not really good at handling proxies and all, it might have challenges in dealing with frameworks running on Kubernetes.
So I think I missed some of what you said. If I want to run these stream processing frameworks on top of Kubernetes, what are the challenges for doing that? Because, I mean, like you said, Kubernetes is this great model for running services. You know, you can frame a stream processing framework as a service, but it's probably not, I mean, it doesn't sound like that's the same idea of an abstraction of a service that you think of Kubernetes as being well suited to. But what if I do? What if I'm just like, I insist on running my stream processing on Kubernetes? What's difficult about that?
So think about it, like, say, for example, you are running a stream processing framework like Kafka or Heron, or like many of these frameworks which are very popular. So if you are Kafka master or you are Heron master, you know that you know which stream is, for example, a higher priority than the other stream, right? For example, if there are user clicks that you care about versus the transaction clicks. There are like multiple examples that I can give, but this I'm giving one example of a notion of priority, for example. So in the Kubernetes worldview, because the rate limiting happens at the API gateway, not at the framework specific way, you can be basically rate limited at the gateway itself. And if the transaction, and because it's the same framework, the scheduling, the streaming is the same framework, you can be start to be dropping the transaction request just because the, say for example, the click request is just flooding in because it's rate limited. Now, compare that to a Mesos model where all of this is done by Mesos, by the application framework, not Mesos, where you can decide, okay, I don't care about click rates for now because it's having too much traffic. I can be doing rate limiting separately for both of the streams, things like that. So this is one example. I don't know if it's convincing, but whenever you think about anything that the framework can be doing better rather than the Kubernetes is what I'm I think will be a big difference. So in this case, for example, in the streaming case, rate limiting, dropping the packets in the database world also, that's very, like, you want to, for example, prioritize some things over others, even though it's the same framework, even though it supports of the same framework. You as an application framework have more knowledge about what this means in the application specific way rather than in a generic service way.
Software Engineering Daily has 20,000 engineers listening Monday through Friday. If you are hiring, or if you have a product that you would like to get into the hands of engineers, send me an email. Jeff@softwareengineeringdaily.com. This podcast is sustained by the advertisers, and if you would like to become one, or even if you're just curious and you want to learn more, send me an email, Jeff@softwareengineeringdaily.com. Thanks for listening. We haven't talked about database workloads as much. We've been talking about service workloads and streaming processing workloads. What about if I want to run MongoDB or Cassandra or some other database on Kubernetes or on Mesos? What are the differences there? What would be preferable to run those on?
Yeah, so it's a good question. I think it's a very good question. So again, because the Kubernetes has this worldview of single services model, currently there are people who are trying to run Cassandra and other databases on Kubernetes, and it sort of works. I wouldn't say it doesn't work, but if you think about the database workload, right? I mean, you want to get the last byte of performance out of all this, and you don't want to be bounded by all the other things that is going on in the system. I think this is again something that is very application specific. So in the Mesos world, I think Mesos has like probably more than 12 database frameworks already, Mongo, Cassandra, like you name it. All of these frameworks already ported, yeah, run out of the box on Mesos. So if I give you one example, right, for if you are mounting the data, so currently the way you would do a data framework, database framework on Kubernetes is you mount an external disk onto your Kubernetes database service, and that takes care of it. Now, this is okay-ish, but if you think about it, that's just not ideal. Like if you lose a disk for say, because it is say it is remote and mounted, if there is a network glitch for 1 minute, what do you do? Like, this is one of those questions where these applications. If you start to replicate, for example, because you don't want to lose your data to a new replication, that will also mean that you will flood the other two replicas that are active, and you might also risk breaking them down. Versus in the Mesos world, you can actually say, oh, okay, wait a minute. I know there is a network glitch, and I can be waiting for this for a while. And I can actually know what data was that on that disk, and how many of those copies are already there on the other replicas, and how many are not. So this is the application specific insight. These are the kind of application specific insight that you can have on the in the Mesos world, which you will lose if you just say this is a state machine, run it for me in the Kubernetes world.
Got it.
So,
okay, let's talk about some higher level views. So, like, how companies are using Mesos or perhaps Kubernetes. Although you've written, I think, more about Mesos. we talked some about Netflix, and I did an entire show about Netflix's scheduling. Actually, a couple shows about how Netflix does scheduling. You've also looked at Uber. Uber has published case studies about how they use Mesos. How does Uber use Mesos?
So there are a number of big companies that are using Mesos, right from Apple to like Twitter.
Oh yeah, Apple. Of course, Uber. Apple has like the largest deployment, right?
Yeah, Apple has. So Siri runs on. That's what they came out last year saying Siri is what runs on. They have a custom scheduler. So these are the kind of application-specific frameworks which you will not be able to do very easily saying state machine. Like, I don't know how you will specify Siri as a state machine. Siri framework as a state machine. So there are a number of big companies. Like, Uber is one big example. Netflix is one big example. There are enough database companies out there who are using Mesos very seriously. Twitter is a very big example. In terms of how they use this, if you see, I think it goes into similar vein. Like, most of the people start Mesos when they are having one or two workloads, and then they sort of grow because Mesos gives them flexibility then of running things on the same infrastructure side by side. The number of frameworks they run on typically grows very fast because it's so easy and it gives you so the utilization and all. So Netflix example is very, very interesting because they run already on the cloud. And the fact that they are getting around 40% of the savings is, I think, I remember off the top of my head, just because they use Mesos instead of directly running things on. So you can be saying, I can be just because I have everything in my Docker containers, I can just be running directly Docker containers on top of the Amazon infrastructure. Just because they use Mesos for almost all their scheduling, they are able to absorb the capacity that is lying around into a smaller number of infrastructure machines that they need. And they're getting 40% or so improvement in terms of how much the infrastructure they need. And that's a big win for someone like Amazon, someone like Netflix. Uber, I have had some conversation with Uber people. So Uber is a big user of Mesos, and they are also considering things like moving to clouds with Mesos. So I don't know if that's public.
I thought they were already on AWS.
Okay, I don't know. There are a number of Apple, for example, is like known to be using their own infrastructure. There are companies like Twitter that they use their own infrastructure, and because of Mesos, they are able to leverage. So Mesos provides two things. One, it gives you this nice utilization of your infrastructure that you have, and second, it gives you this flexibility of writing your own distributed apps. I think that's very undervalued by a lot of people who haven't played with Mesos a lot. I mean, if you are just trying to run a web server on your web machines, I'm sure, you don't need Mesos. You probably also don't need Kubernetes in that case. But as more and more frameworks starts to show up in your infrastructure, I think Mesos has a lot of value add, and lots of companies are, like Airbnb was one of the big examples. So lots of good companies are out there. It's pretty mature. I think that's another reason that people overlook. You don't want it into your infrastructure piece to be, I don't know, very, very fast moving. On the same note, I think the infrastructure, the piece that you brought, right? This is a bit of side note, but so Mesos being a data center kernel is like few hundred thousand lines of code, all in all, and Kubernetes is like, I don't know, a year old or so, and it has few million line of code. So I think last time I checked, I think it's 3.4 million line plus code. So that's a lot of code to be managing, to be running in your infrastructure as a base layer, and then you are running things on top. So there are basically trade-offs that you are making when you are making infrastructure choices, and people should be making informed choices. I think that's very important.
Interesting. Well, I mean, the Kubernetes, it's hard to know how much was ported from Borg, and Borg has obviously had tons of work done on it.
Yes, I think as far as I have been if you see in the KubeCon talks also. So what has been said is it's not the same code base. It's a code base that is written from scratch for the Kubernetes. Yeah, so that's what my impression is. I never worked for Google, so I don't know. But they basically wanted a new. So if you look at their Borg paper and Omega papers, they very clearly say that their internal scheduler basically was a big monolith, and that had hundreds and hundreds of special rules for different application, and that started to grow unmanageable. And then they want to, so that's why all the new framework that they wanted was supposed to, it's definitely something that they wanted as a two-phase scheduler rather than the single-phase scheduler.
Do you see anything else interesting at the KubeCon videos, or I don't know if you attended KubeCon? I wanted to go, but I didn't go this year.
So same. I have stopped going to any of these big conferences. So I didn't.
Too much of a distraction.
It's too much of. I think it's far less productive. Far more productive is to meet people outside, have a good conversation with them. I think that's what I did with DockerCon. That's what I did with MesoCon. So it's interesting. I watched some of the videos. I watched the videos of. I'm basically interested in how the Kubernetes project goes about to add support for data frameworks and data infrastructure all in all. So I think because that's going to be very interesting, because that's not sort of native to their notion of how they see the world. So I want to see how they're going to evolve into that. There was interesting talk about adding GPU support on that too. So I think that there's a couple of talks. So these are which are stretching the boundaries of Kubernetes, and they're very interesting to me. I have had this background in scheduler for like 5 years, and I love seeing how the abstractions are getting extended and pushed. So yeah, I would be really, really, really interested in see how they support GPU, how they support multiple schedulers, how they support data infrastructure, all that.
It's so funny what you say about conferences. I've been going to a lot of conferences for the past year and a half since starting Software Engineering Daily. For me, it's fun because it's like you just kind of like get a touch base with like the ecosystem, is where the ecosystem comes together. And you see all these vendors. And you walk between the vendor booths, and it's like, okay, here's this vendor's view of the world, and here's this vendor's view of the world, and you know, here's how they're crafting their marketing materials. And I don't know, maybe it's not a useful.
I think it's useful, but I generally do that just looking at the product page. I think what they say on their product page. I mean, if you see the Red Hat product page of Kubernetes versus the CoreOS Kubernetes offering, or versus the AWS Kubernetes offering, it's very clear on what their value proposition is for each of these companies.
What are you working on these days? What company are you working at, or are you doing something on your own?
No, I work for Microsoft.
Okay, you still work for Microsoft,
I was with Microsoft Research for a long time, and then I'm now with Microsoft. I work in Microsoft HD Insight, so that's basically like data processing as a service. Like we run Hadoop, Hadoop, Spark, Kafka.
I've talked to some people from HD Insight at, I think I talked to at Strata.
Oh yeah, we can talk about who did you meet?
I can't remember who I met. I can't remember who it was. I can't remember his name. I was trying to get a show together about that, because I think Microsoft is doing a lot of interesting work in this area.
It's very interesting. So that's why it's very interesting to see how this data framework collide with this new worldview of the resource allocation. So
yeah, and I mean, we haven't even talked about the cloud providers yet. I mean, we've talked about the Mesos and Kubernetes, or Mesos versus Kubernetes, depending on what verbiage you want to use. But I think the cloud provider conversation is equally interesting. So I guess we'll start with Mesosphere. Okay, we could talk about Amazon, we could talk about Microsoft, but let's start with Mesosphere. Mesosphere provides this platform and support for Apache Mesos. And I've read about a lot of companies that provide platform and support for Kubernetes, whether it's Google or Rancher Labs or Prenda. Why do companies decide to, or how do companies choose between these different providers?
I think in terms of Mesos, I think there's Mesosphere is like sort of like default and the big choice. I don't know a lot of other companies which have the Mesosphere as having number of good people.
They have like the flagship Mesos developers on their team.
Yeah, so they have like a founder, Benjamin is there. Like there are the number of people that, they're very good at what they're doing. How do people choose infrastructure provider? I think it's It's a very interesting conversation, even in the context of the cloud and how they choose, how different people choose different clouds. If you see, right, like, I think for like, I don't know, say 60-70% of the people out there, I think all the three clouds right now, for example, provides more or less the same features that they need. So I think that there is a, I do believe there is a worldview in which, based on which people decide what they're comfortable with. Like in Kubernetes, for example, people who choose CoreOS versus people who choose Red Hat are more or less very different, or versus people who choose, I don't know, some other companies. So I think it's more about how comfortable you are in the long-term relationship with the provider, like cloud. I think it's a more long-term than just a feature-based head-to-head comparison. Of course, that matters. I'm not saying it doesn't matter, but I'm saying features are more or less becoming more and more equal. And one of the often ignored fact about this is long-term relationship with the company.
Yeah, and probably how much bandwidth you can allocate to your Mesos cluster. Like if you're like an insurance company with not a lot of engineers and you want to go to Mesos, you probably are going to go with Mesosphere. You don't want to go deploy your own Mesos thing on AWS. You would rather just have another layer between you and the provider.
Yep. So I think that's a very good point. Like most of the people should not be running Mesos or Kubernetes on their own. I mean, it's like, again, like there are only, I don't know, two companies in the world which are doing the operations for operating system. One is Red Hat, one is Microsoft. So you don't want to be in that because most of the company's value provision is higher up in the chain. You know what you're doing good, and you should be focusing on that. And let the infrastructure management piece be managed by someone who knows it how to do better.
Okay, so if you're a company that wants to go with, you want to do all the deployment yourself, you want to configure your infrastructure, you don't want to go with something higher up the stack like Mesosphere. If you want to deploy to Amazon or you want to deploy to Microsoft Azure or Google Cloud or DigitalOcean, you want to manage the stuff yourself. You mentioned this worldview thing. You know, different people have different worldviews that map to the infrastructure provider that they end up going with. What are those worldviews?
The one worldview is startup worldview, where I say for them the iteration cycles matter far, far more than the stability. I think there's a slider between the iteration cycle and the stability so startup is at sort of one end of it, where you require lots and lots of fast iterations versus the stability, where, I don't know, someone like Walmart or someone like some big old company where technology is very, very important to them, but the stability is also very important. I don't, like G, for example, like you don't want your healthcare monitors go down just because, you know, somebody decided there's a new JavaScript framework out there, I want to try it out. So so these are two different worldviews in terms of how the iteration cycle is there. The second worldview is the experience and the comfort level of people working on these teams. As you said, like in the finance, that worldview is very different than the things, for example, that someone like, I don't know, even in finance, for example, there are people who just want some of the queries to be answered versus, there are people who really want last piece of infrastructure performance getting out of their way. So I think it's what you have been doing in past, and in terms of like in terms of your team. If you have a team which is very, very comfortable managing infrastructure, has a bunch of knowledge, and does not get distracted by the coolness of infrastructure management, because I've seen this at times. Versus someone who just wants to get things done at the higher level. I think if you are a JavaScript framework developer, I mean, you don't care about Docker containers, where they run. Like, you care about like your framework. So that's very. So the front end, back end is one such dichotomy. The stability iteration is another dichotomy. The enterprise versus non-enterprise is one dichotomy, like where there's lots and lots of large teams versus small number of teams These are all choices and trade-offs.
And also, the cloud platforms seem to be diverging somewhat, or they, you can see these specializations taking shape, like Google with Kubernetes perhaps being, you know, that's a compelling reason to go with GCP, or Dataflow, you know, they're building up an expertise in their streaming thing, which all of the, you know, you talk to people at the different streaming things, and a lot of them say, oh, Dataflow is a great model for doing things. And then AWS, you know, there seems like they're putting a big bet on Lambda, on the serverless stuff. And Microsoft has its bets on, yeah, well, sure, Azure Functions, but I was going to say that in terms of the specializations, like really getting enterprises that are really deep into Windows platforms, like how do you, you know, move to a place where your economics are much better because you're on the cloud? Like that's a huge amount of work. So these, you know, you have these big infrastructure providers, and they do have their overlapping functionality, but they also have their distinct characteristics for the customers that they can go after, because the cloud is such a big environment. So it's not like a winner take all thing.
So I think you mentioned a very good point. Like you see how even though it's the same functionality like Lambda, like you see very different implementation of the same thing. Even in the data space, it's actually very visible. If you see how Amazon thinks about the data frameworks that they the data services that they offer versus how Google thinks about it and how Microsoft thinks about it. So it's very different. Microsoft thinks about HD Insight as sort of, Microsoft is always about choices. I think they always like to give customer lots and lots and lots of choices because they know the value of partnership, the value of not eating up the value chain of your partner and things like that, which is something that you learn if you are doing enterprise business for 20 years, but which is not something that you learn if you are doing enterprise business for last 10 years, which is Amazon, quote unquote. And if it's not something that you learn if you are doing enterprise business for 5 years, which is sort of Google. So it's very interesting how they look at partnership, how they look at the data frameworks. So if you look at ADLA and HD Insight, that offering that Microsoft has, that looks very different from EMR offering, and that looks very different from Google offering of data proc. Like I can go into detail on how that looks different, but there'll be digression. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, I wanted to ask you about serverless, because, you know, we've talked about microservice workloads, we've talked about data workloads, we've talked about database workloads a little bit. Are serverless workloads this other class of workload type that we're going to have, that we're going to be thinking about more seriously in the future when we think about like how our data center operating system accepts different types of requests?
I generally view serverless frameworks at again a higher level. So if you think about like what I mean, a higher level in the stack is like there is an infrastructure OS, then there is a service frameworks which knows how to run things like Kafka and like Kubernetes and things like that. And then there are things built on top of it, like okay, you know how to run Spark, but then you want to build an app on top of Spark, right? So I think serverless fits at that layer where it says I know what my function should be doing. I don't care about where you run it. I don't care about how you make sure that it's up and performing at the highest level and things like that. I just want to run this function. So I think it's at the layer which sits above all the framework layer. So framework layer is where you know how to run Spark, you know how to run Hadoop, you know how to run blah. And then on the value chain top is the serverless frameworks where you know this is image processing, or this is machine learning, or this is, I don't know, like rendering framework. So this is where serverless, I think, shines, and it's irrespective of what frameworks are using and how the infrastructure is being. It's a great new direction. It's basically putting your mouth where the where the money is. So yeah.
Cool. Well, Dharmesh, thanks for coming on the show. It's been great talking to you. I'm glad you reached out over email, and you know, we had a great conversation about how Kubernetes and Mesos are not necessarily overlapping. They're different layers of the stack, and I think this episode was a very useful explanation for some of those things in more detail. Thanks to Symphono for sponsoring Software Engineering Daily. Symphono is a custom engineering shop where senior engineers tackle big tech challenges while learning from each other. Check it out at symphono.com/sedaily. That's symphono.com/sedaily. Thanks again, Symphono.
Wow.